Welcome, and thank you for finding your way here to our online worship service at Fairbanks First United Methodist Church. I'm Caroline. I'm the praise band leader here, and we just want you to know that we're happy you could join us today for the service. You're going to hear some scripture and prayers and praise music and traditional music, and it's all sung and spoken to God's glory. Thanks for being here, and enjoy the service.
Please join us in singing Behold Him.
He who was before there was light, walked across the pages of time. He who made every living thing, behold Him. He who heard humanity's cry, left His throne to wake as a child. He became like the least of us. Behold Him, Jesus, Son of God, Messiah, the Lamb, the roaring lion. Oh, be still and behold Him. Who died with sinners and saints, healed the blind, the lost, and the lame. Even now He is in our midst. Behold Him. He who chose a criminal's end, paid with blood to settle our debt, buried death as He rose to life.
Thank you for worshiping with us here at First United Methodist Church in Fairbanks, Alaska, just below the Arctic Circle, where our days are getting longer and longer. Today is March 10th, the fourth Sunday in Lent. Hopefully you remember to spring your clocks ahead 1 hour before you went to bed last night. Today, again, we celebrate Girl Scout Sunday here in Fairbanks United Methodist Church. And next Sunday, we'll have our Young at Heart potluck at 6 p.m. Most nations, including our own, have strict rules about bringing animals and fruit into the country. You don't want some pest taking over and upsetting the ecosystem. The people with Moses have an invasive pest with them, and it's really not the poisonous snakes. Together, let us pray. Holy God, you have done many marvelous things, yet we are a rational people, and talk of miracles sometimes makes us uneasy. Help us to trust in you. Give us the grace to experience your presence, even in those things we don't understand, and help us now to feel the miracle of your word working in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen now for a word from the Lord as I read from Numbers chapter 21, verses 4 through 9. From Mount Hor, they set out by the way to the Red Sea to go around the land of Edom. But the people became discouraged on the way. The people spoke against God and against Moses. Why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there's no food, no water, and we detest this miserable food. Then the Lord sent poisonous serpents amongst the people, and they bit the people, and so many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord take away the serpents from us." So Moses prayed for the people, and the Lord said to Moses, "Make a poisonous serpent and set it on a bronze pole, and everyone who is bitten shall look at it and live." So Moses made a serpent of bronze and put it upon a pole, and whenever a serpent bit someone, that person would look up at the serpent of bronze and live. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. these have in common? Snakehead fish, lionfish, choke cherry trees. What do they have in common? They're called invasive species. The northern snakehead fish was brought into the U.S. by a man that wanted the creature for medicinal purposes. At some point, he tossed it into a Maryland pond and it began to feast on the native fish throughout the Chesapeake region. Its mouth shape and its coloring resembled a snake, hence the name. They spawn multiple times a year, where as many of the more desirable sport fish only spawn once a year. They can live in stagnant water because they actually breathe air from the surface. They've been known to be able to crawl through the mud, and in some regions have become called the walking fish. This invasive species did provide fodder for movie makers between 2004 and 2006 with such hits as Frankenfish, Snakehead Terror, and Swarm of the Snakehead. On the brighter side, it's open season year-round on snakehead, and they're said to be quite tasty. They have the firmness of tilapia with no gaminess or fishiness in the flavor. The lionfish, and I've seen these up close myself, stripping the coral reefs in the Caribbean near Mexico. Mexico has a search and destroy policy that you may kill the fish on sight. And many times our dive master, who was Mexican, many times that's exactly what he did. The U.S., of course, has allocated millions of dollars to study the problem. It's speculated that this very regal, beautiful-looking fish was probably brought from Asia to decorate someone's fish tank. And it turned out probably to be more than what the owner was ready for, so it somehow got dumped into the sea. Now, one way, of course, you can help reduce the invasive species is to find a way to turn them into a tasty delicacy, and you can do that. There is such a website as lionfishcentral.org where people are encouraged to share their lionfish recipes. Invasive species are dangerous because they have no natural enemies in the place that they're invading, no native predators to control their growth. Even the chokecherries, yes, the chokecherries, which are all over parts of Alaska, pose a threat. Spread by way of being eaten and then passed on by unsuspecting animals. Alaska Fish and Wildlife reported on the death of moose calves by chokecherry ingestion, which, depending on certain conditions, can actually be very high in poison. And speculates that there may even be more that wander off and die in the wilderness undetected. The chokecherry, a flowering tree, probably imported by people wanting to recreate their beautiful lawns and gardens of the lower 48. But it's said that the wood makes good furniture and firewood, and some have even learned how to turn the chokecherries themselves into a jam. So, this coming spring, when I am cutting down all my chokecherries, you can feel free to come over, harvest the cherries. I'm keeping the wood, however. In the book of Numbers, the people of Israel are on the move, headed towards the promised land. As they pass the land around Edom, the people become impatient, and they speak against God and Moses and say, "Why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there's no food, no water, and we hate this miserable food." Suddenly, they're invaded after spitting their venom at God and Moses. They're invaded by a species of poisonous serpents. The creatures bite them, and many Israelites die. Unlike a pest that might ruin a farmer's crops, God sends these snakes and they kill the people. The people are saying, "Oh, it would have been better for us to die in Egypt than here in the desert without food and water." So God says, "Okay, I'll put you out of your misery for your faithlessness, gutless, whining, complaining, excuse of a people." They asked to die, so God obliged them. Then the people rushed to Moses, crying out for help. "We've sinned by speaking against the Lord and against you. Pray to the Lord to take away the serpents from us." Well, it's kind of like they're saying, we didn't mean it. We didn't mean it. The people of Israel need help with this deadly killer, but they don't run to the Department of Agriculture or the Environmental Protection Agency. Instead, they go to Moses, who prays for the people. And God offers Moses a solution. To make a poisonous serpent out of bronze and set it on a pole, says the Lord, and everyone who's bitten shall look at it and live. So Moses crafts the serpent of bronze, puts it on a pole, and it works. Whenever someone is bit, they look at it and they live. Invasive species can do tremendous amount of harm, but can also be controlled with the right intervention. But what is the invasive pest in this story? It's true that invasive species in this story may not be the serpents, but the impatience, the complaints, the anger of the people of Israel. These are the pests that infested the Israelites with disastrous consequences and continue to afflict us today. There is a bronze serpent, however, that can save us. Consider the invasive species of impatience. Some consider an impatience to be like maybe a respectable sin. But impatience sometimes is just a sign of a bigger problem, namely our own attitude of insisting that others around us conform to our expectations and to our own timetable. That's what the Israelites got into trouble for. They had been in bondage for over 400 years. That's multiple generations. They demand that Moses and God conform to their expectation for a quick and comfortable trip to the promised land, along with an abundant amount of food and water to keep them going along the way. But aren't they called to conform to God's expectations, not the other way around? Impatience is just one of the many things that can shift our focus away from God towards ourselves, so that we begin to believe that the world owes us a life of safety and comfort and convenience. We come to expect it, but it's a pest, it's an invasive species that can eat us up. It comes to lead us to judge others based on the fact that sometimes others can't read our minds and please us without even asking. Then we get upset. That's right, we get upset with the fact that now we have to take it to the next level and we have to complain. Next, complaints. If someone asked you to name the number one sin in the world, you would probably say pride, lust, envy, greed. Others say it might be the sin of complaining. One of the problems with the sin of complaining is that nobody sees it for what it is. It's so universal that many amongst us aren't even aware that it's a sin. Everybody complains about stuff all the time. We're so surrounded by complaining that we hardly notice it, of course, until the complaints are directed against us. We've come to even regard it as a necessity, and we even provide for it the way we provide, say, restrooms and water fountains. Literally, there are places where they'll have either a complaint department or a complaint desk, or sometimes just a form you fill out and can slip it anonymously into a locked box, which of course will be later taken, read over by a complaint committee, prioritized, and of course, signed complaints get priority. But God is not oblivious to complaints. God is so serious about it that he tells the church, do everything without complaining or arguing. We serve not by grumbling and disputing. The idea of disputing includes arguments and quarrels. No, those who serve the Lord should not be known for arguing, but for thankfulness in what is provided. Think about it. When you complain, let's say, about the weather, you've forgotten that the weather is an important part of a balancing act that keeps the planet in what they call the habitable zone. It's already a miracle that we don't broil or freeze to death on this planet. It could be said that complaining is an expression of our pride, a sign that we think we know better than God, or a sign that we don't even realize or that we've forgotten the blessings we have already received. And when we complain about others, we need to be careful, because we reveal our own contempt, our own self-inflation. Examples of finding something on the floor and lamenting, "Oh, don't we pay someone to pick that up?" Or worse, "Don't we have volunteers that pick that up on their free time?" No. We reveal an arrogance when we complain. Once again, the Israelites, they complain, "We detest this miserable food." They're actually not starving. Because notice they said they detest this miserable food. They're getting food. God is sending them manna in the wilderness, but now they're tired of it. Thinking back to Egypt, they remember feasting on fish and cucumbers and melons and leeks and onions and garlic. Because of their complaining, they get a bite that they weren't expecting. The bite from a poisonous serpent. They've revealed their own thanklessness. Another most damaging of invasive species, anger. We see this deadly pest at work and in public life today, especially in politics, with insults being hurled back and forth across the partisan divide to the point where nothing is getting done. We see venom being spewed in the news, venom being spewed on social media. The people of Israel are called to honor and respect God and also his servant Moses, but instead they rail. They rail against their divine and human leaders and accuse them of leading them to their doom. "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us here in the wilderness?" The people shoot their venom at God, and as a result, they receive venom back. After suffering serious casualties from snake attack, the people finally turn to Moses and confess their sin. Admitting that they have sinned, they ask for Moses to pray for them, and Moses does. Impatience, complaints, anger, these are very real problems for us today and for the people in Israel. It's a very real and present danger in the book of Numbers. So this reading doesn't let us forget it. Numbers confronts us with our own blights and blemishes. In this book, we find a self-portrait of ourselves, and we don't like it. At least I hope none of you like it. But how can we stop? How can we become the kind of people God intends us to be, the kind of people we really want to be? In the wilderness, we rediscover God. In the book of Numbers is also a portrait of a God that appears to be both harsh and merciful, severe and gracious, a God who flings killer snakes at impatient, complaining, angry people, who returns venom with venom, a punishment, but also God offers life. God sends a means of salvation by instructing Moses to make a serpent of bronze and put it on a pole so that when the people look at it, they can find new life. But this is an unsettling image. This image of a God that runs hot and cold, this image of a God who gets angry and then relents in God's anger. Before you say, "I don't like this story," or "I don't like the Old Testament," or "I don't like Numbers," remember that in the Old Testament, many times God is simply giving back what was given God. Remember that Jesus knew it well. That's why he used it to describe himself in the Gospel of John, saying, "Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life." When the snakehead fish of sin bites us bad, all we have to do is lift our eyes high on the cross as the Son of Man, inviting those who will trust in him to receive forgiveness and life. Jesus, our bronze serpent, God's innovative invention, God, our Savior, our friend, our guide, those poor snake-bitten rebels in the wilderness. We only have to look up and live. The good news is that God has chosen a means of salvation, this time in Jesus Christ. We're forgiven when we turn to Christ, confess, when we turn away from who we were and become more like the one held up before us. For our lives now and our lives to come. Indeed, eternal life is spoken of in John 3:16. It's not simply a life that drags on forever and ever, but it's a life that draws its purpose from God. Eternal life begins the hour we first believed, just like in the song Amazing Grace. But still, the invasive pests are there. The invasive species of impatience, complaints, and anger are going to try to continue to invade our lives, like the snakehead fish that supposedly now can walk over land, chokecherry seeds that seem to be able to spread everywhere into every nook and cranny. So can anger, impatience, and complaints climb into the cracks and our defenses and seek us out when we're sleeping. We need to be vigilant as individuals and as a faith community and swat these pests when they appear, name them for what they are, and in do so, taking away their power. Invasive species cannot survive if we give them nothing to eat. So when you're feeling impatient, take a breath. When you want to complain, remind yourself of the blessings you've received. And when you feel that rush of anger, remember that everyone is not your enemy, that sometimes you can be your own worst enemy, and that everyone actually like you is also a child of God. Starve those invasive species until they're gone from your life forever. We thank you for your support, your generosity, your willingness to sign up and to put forth your efforts. Right now, of course, we're looking for folks to sign up to help clean the church, folks that enjoy providing meals for our potlucks. It's so deeply appreciated. We thank you for all that. The folks that are going to volunteer and cook the Easter breakfast coming at the end of the month, just dropping ahead, Easter Sunday, 8 a.m. to 12 noon. Let us pray. How impatient you must feel, O Lord, at our reluctance sometimes to freely give, for you are a generous God. Enable us to see the needs in our neighborhoods, in our faith community, and in our world. Stir within us a yearning to help our desire to give overtakes our resistance to giving or participating, and our impatience turns inward, for we cannot count the cost. So let us live fully and continue to grow. In Jesus' name, amen.
Singing No Longer Slaves.
You unraveling with a melody, you surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave. your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Oh, 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 oh. You set the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand and sing. I am a child of God. You split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears were drowned in perfect love. You rescued me so I could stand.
Let them prophesy with your voice, sisters.
us take a moment to take our feelings of loss and grief and pain and disappointments and fear, to take them to the Lord. Let us pray. O Lord, it's hard to be in the middle of anything. And yet, here we are, in the middle of Lent. We can begin to well with enthusiasm and commitment. We can also prepare for the joy and the celebration yet to come. But we need your presence to make the middle meaningful as we cross this desert of Lent. Heal where we have been. Listen in these moments for the stillness in our souls. Hear what we want to become. Recreate us anew as we journey now through Lent, that we might come to know this mystery of faith, that we are so loved far more than we could deserve or earn. Help us to claim this truth as our own. Awaken us to the reality that you loved us enough to give us your best, your only Son, Jesus. In thanksgiving for this gift of love, inspire us to love others, to not only lift up in prayer others, but to go and do, go and speak, go and be peace to others. As we come to you with that prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And remember, as you go forth, you are a people of faith, surrounded always by the love and grace of a patient God. Therefore, go from this place, or wherever you are, renewed in faith that you might bring hope to a troubled world through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please join us in singing Today is the Day.
I'm casting my cares aside. I'm leaving my past behind. I'm setting my heart and mind on you. My hands to yours, believing there's so much more, knowing that all you have in store for me is good. Is good. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I won't what you say. Today is the day. Today is the day. I'm putting my fears aside. I'm leaving my doubts behind. I'm giving my hopes and dreams to you, Jesus. I'm reaching my hands to yours, believing there's so much more, knowing that all you have in store for me is good. Is good. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. I won't worry about tomorrow, trusting in what you say. You have made. I will rejoice. rejoice and be glad in it.